your attention, please.
Yo, yo. You ready for this? Coming at you from Wicked Big Studios in Peabody, Massachusetts.
Ladies and gentlemen,
sit back, buckle up, because you're in the happy hour with your boy.
What's up, everybody, and welcome back to the happy hour, guys. It's good to be back here in the Wicked Big Studios and Lounge in West Peabody, Massachusetts. Quick shout out to everybody. I mean, we really had a fantastic podcast last week with Ed Connors. If you guys haven't heard it yet, get over Apple, Spotify, Stitcher, Spreaker, you name it, we're there. The happy hour KINGHAP podcast, guys, give it a listen. And anywhere that you hear it, make sure if you're listening and you're enjoying what you're hearing, even if you ain't, leave a goddamn five-star review. I'll tell you what, guys, it's good to have everybody here. I need to go ahead and let everybody know we're being brought to you today by our friends at Old School Labs. Yes, Old School Labs, they are partnering up with me for my recovery here, trying to get back from this ankle injury, guys. I'll tell you what, I cannot get enough of the tiramisu-flavored protein. They also have a lemon cheesecake one, and I'll tell you, man, it is delicious. 1 gram of carbs. Also, I'm taking the creatine, and the other one I'm taking right now is Vintage Build for right after your workout, guys. It is awesome. Keep your pumps all day. We're going to be looking good this summer with Old School Labs. Promo code KINGHAP. Save you 15% site-wide. Also, being brought to you today by our friends at Recess. Yes, guys, takearecess.com. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 15% site-wide. The people over at Recess are tickled pink with the Happy Hour Social Club, guys. Make sure you get over there. Show them some love. When you're enjoying your recess, take a picture, throw it on social media, tag them, let them know you found out about it from your boy KINGHAP, guys. Everybody is so pumped up with the support, guys. Please keep it coming. And I'll tell you what, last week we had a great talk. We talked about California. We talked about Gold's Gym. And I'll tell you, what we did is we brought in, I mean, guys, this is a treat for you. This is a treat for me. And I'll tell you what, I mean, without any further ado, I want to introduce today's guest. This man is the producer, director, and cameraman for the Dream Big documentary, ladies and gentlemen. What this movie is, if you don't know and you haven't heard of it, where the hell you been? Under a rock? I mean, this is a love letter to Southern California. The 1970s, the people and the gym that changed the cultural landscape of the country. I'll tell you what, guys, please give a warm welcome for my man, Marc Martinez. Marc, what's up, brother? Good to have you.
Hey, thanks, Mike. Thanks for the great introduction. Thanks for having me.
No doubt. I mean, it's great to have you here. And I'll tell you what a lot of people don't know. I mean, you yourself, you were young then, but you were at Gold's back right before, Ed Connors actually purchased the place. And you were there during the previous ownership before that. And this is when, I mean, basically, I mean, let's just say fitness and the fitness culture and the culture of people completely changed down in California. And I'll tell you what, it must have, I mean, from what I hear from this fantastic documentary, guys, you need to see this documentary. But from what I've seen, it's like, this is the type of world where people like you and I would love to see back. But I mean, unfortunately, history is history, but what a time that must have been, big man.
Yeah, it certainly was. You know, growing up in it, you kind of, you know, you don't realize it until you look back. Yep. You know, kind of like, I mean, I'm sure there's things in Massachusetts that you look back at like, oh, those were the days. And as you're living them day to day, they're great. But only until you get a chance to look back, you go, wow, you know, things have changed. And that's pretty cool. I mean, it was. I think it was, you know, 70s, I was a teenager, and you're coming off the, the momentum of the counterculture from the 60s. Yep. And the last vestiges of the hippies who basically felt right at home in a place like Venice, you know, and then that kind of became the seedbed for, bodybuilders to be able to walk around. In Venice, they were just like another weirdo in Venice. They didn't stick out. If they had been in a more white picket fence area of LA, I'm sure they would have got a lot more ridicule than they already did. But there, it's like no one even bothered them. Plus, it was cheap to live.
Oh, yeah. And one of the things with me that I've seen, and I will get into this later on, but I know Pete Grimkowski, who is an owner with Ed Karnas, Happy Hour Social Club member. But here's one of the things. It's like people went down there. They lived very inexpensively. They woke up in the morning. I mean, they got $1.29 weightlifter breakfast, which I thought is amazing. Talking like 7 eggs, hash browns, and toast for $1.29. Then they go to the beach and digest. You hit the gym. And I mean, if you were one of the suckers that worked, then it was off to work, right? I mean, some people worked all night to work out during the day. But I mean, people were just out riding bikes, roller skating, skateboarding on down, you know, the boardwalk there. And everybody was just living their best life, walking around wearing, you know, shorts, t-shirts, working out. And it just seemed like a total different world than we live in, you know, today. Correct?
Yeah. And you know, Venice was, Santa Monica, which is just right north of Venice, you know, they butt up against each other. And Santa Monica was kind of where I think people felt safe. It was a beautiful seaside community. There was the pier. The Academy Awards were held there one time at the Santa Monica Civic. Really nice, well-manicured lawns and expensive homes north of Wilshire. And that was Santa Monica. Then you'd go down Main Street and you would cross Rose Avenue. It became Venice.
Yep.
And, you know, it got a bit dicey, but the rents were cheap. And, you know, like you saw in the documentary, you know, there were guys that were living on the beach for anywhere from an apartment from 150 to $250 a month. And even in 1970s LA, that was cheap, you know, because, yeah, I mean, Venice had kind of a sketchy reputation. There was a place where basically they would have halfway homes. So guys that had to matriculate back into society from prison, it's like, well, there's a couple of halfway homes in Venice, just throw them there. There was a story what Franco told me.
Yep.
And Ken Sprague did as well, where at one point in time, there was a biker gang clubhouse right next to Gold's. And they said it was funny because Franco said the biker guys with their chains hanging off and their belts and their jackets and their helmets, they would cross the street so they didn't have to walk in front of Gold's because they didn't know what was going to happen with what they thought were crazy bodybuilders. And then they would cross back to get to their place. So, you know, it was, I mean, definitely a moment in history.
Yep. And one of the things I was going to say, one of the places that I've been down, you know, to Venice Beach, you know, that I walked around down there, had some meals, actually a couple great guys from the Happy Hour Social Club down there. I was down there with Taco from Wednesday night and Thursday Night Fame here on the network. We were down there, you know, having a good time. And I'll tell you what, there were some, you could tell that there was some seedy characters down there, but at the same time, a lot of people down there having a lot of, fun. Yeah. I mean, I'm going to tell you, a lot of people around there were wearing marijuana cologne. I was doing and back in the day, and, you know, I'm sure that was very, you know, exciting. And, you know, people, that was back then, that was a big thing in the 70s. And Bo Ballin on the budget says Muscle Beach. I visited the gym there that's currently reopened and owned by the state, as if I'm the recreation department, if I'm not mistaken. But back in the day, that was a place that was actually closed down, right? Because of some seedy characters hanging out in the area, correct?
Yeah, well, the original Muscle Beach that was closed down was in Santa Monica, just south of the pier, and that was the place where, you know, guys like Zabo were at, Steve Reeves, Dillinger, Clancy Raw, you know, all those guys from that era. And it was either 1959 officially when the city of Santa Monica had said we're closing this down.
Yeah.
And they said, like, one day the equipment was gone off the beach, and it was that. So the city of Los Angeles did a little while later build that outdoor platform. And if you've, you know, looked at the book Pumping Iron or even seen the movie, yep, where Arnold and Franco were lifting out there, that's down in Venice. And that became the what they called Muscle Beach.
Yes.
Yeah. And even that, if you were out there recently, it's got bleachers, got like concrete bleachers and everything. It's like back then it was like a little rusted chain link fence, rusted weights, like, you know, ratty wood, little league bleachers, you know, it wasn't fancy at all.
That's funny you say that, because you know what, when I seen those bleachers, now this is because at the time I was, you know, I guess I was ignorant to the situation, because I said, wow, those concrete bleachers must have been there for, you know, decades and decades. Yeah. You know what I'm saying? Cause I thought that they were from the 70s and 80s. Yeah. That's not the case though. Correct.
No. Yeah. That's a relatively recent, development. I mean, I live up in the Bay Area now. But when I went down to interview Manny Perry, you know, he was talking about the improvements that that the city of Los Angeles had done. And I think some people through the city and county of LA have said, let's clean it up. Yep. You know, let's make it a nicer amenity. And they now have little plaques of the Muscle Beach Hall of Fame around the platform. The equipment is really nice in there now.
Way with seagull shit on the equipment, you know, when you're trying to work out, which I kind of thought to myself, that would kind of maybe hurt my motivation to work out. But there was some, when I was down there, there were some big boys there. So that would help with the motivation. One of my questions that I have though, right? And we're going to talk all show about all this stuff, but I need to know. So you walk into the gym, right? Now, well, we're talking about these monsters that are down at Muscle Beach. You move up the street. I mean, probably what, 15 minutes from Muscle Beach now is the Mecca of bodybuilding, which is Gold's Gym. And now my question to you is, you walk in there at 17 years old, how intimidated were you?
I was probably too stupid to be, but at part, I remember part of me was, and I've said this in interviews before, where one of my high school buddies was getting recruited for the University of Washington to play football.
Yep.
And so, and he was actually a big Arnold fan. You know, even though he was playing football and lifting weights, you know, he was on about Arnold, and we drove out together to Gold's. And the funny thing was, he, even though he loved Arnold, he was a football player. So he thought, you know, like bodybuilders, you know, they're, you know, kissing their biceps in front of the mirror. And we walk in the gym and, you know, we see several guys. One of the guys that I saw in the magazine, Rudy Hermosillo, who was Sylvester Stallone, one of Sylvester Stallone's bodyguards, and he won the Teenage Mr. America. He was actually working out that very first day. And Robbie was there. There was a lot of AAU competitors, Larry Gordon, Richard Baldwin, a lot of guys that you would see in the magazine of that era, you know. And then you're just like, you know, this is the first time you see top level bodybuilder.
Yes, you're talking top food chain guys here.
Yeah, exactly.
And I'll tell you what, a lot of people don't realize either. And I can tell you, even I didn't, but some of these guys that are the professional bodybuilders, when you see them off season and they're not all sucked out in all the water, right, you don't realize how friggin' large these people are. I mean, these are big boys. And, you know, I mean, I've lucky enough, I've had the privilege of meeting a lot of the Mr. Olympia competitors out at the event. And I'll tell you, I've stood next to Phil Heath and Jay Cutler, Big Rami. I mean, I got a picture of Big Rami. He looks like I'm standing next to my refrigerator. It's insane. And to think that he's probably 30 pounds lighter at the show because he's sucking all the water out. These people don't realize, you walk into a room with these people, and one of the things is like Gold's Gym, it's like they didn't need to tint those windows because they were always covered in steam and everything else, right? I mean, that's just how it goes, and people don't really realize that. What they also don't realize is how this gym transcended the entire forget about the city, but this area became an area where it was kind of a carefree area. People were like just down there having fun, music, and like I said, some, you know, music, some medicinal marijuana. Also, you know, a lot of bodybuilding, people working out, having fun. It was almost like Woodstock, for God's sakes. Everybody down there was kind of like hippies and having a great time and a great life. And I mean, something that I envy looking at from now, people working 2-3 jobs and trying to go. But no, back then it was like, I got to scrape together $1.50 and the rest of it is workout and party time. I mean, that must have been an amazing time to be down there.
Yeah, you know, the guys I interviewed, you know, they had mentioned that. And, you know, like Bill Grant had said in the movie, he, you know, he worked for American Airlines. So he was working down at LAX, which is probably about 15 miles south of Venice. And he said, and back then, when airlines actually gave you meals and good meals, he said anything that was still sealed and not ordered or used, we were able to take it with us home. He said, so I would come home with trays of food. He goes, I was getting paid well from American Airlines with my job. And then I think he said his monthly stipend from Joe Weider was like $250. And he goes, that took care of my rent. I had free food and then my money from my job. And he said, I was just, you know, like that line he said, you know, the world I lived in was the best world I ever lived in at that time, you know, and he summed it up perfectly, I think.
Another thing that was said during your movie that I loved was towards the end, and I ain't gonna give away, guys. If you're here for spoilers, I ain't gonna tell you anything like that. But I'll tell you what, one thing that was said in the movies at the end was one of the gentlemen said, if you could take a time machine back to the 70s and 80s or whatever, you wouldn't come back. And I, you know what, I tend to think that that's pretty accurate. I always said that I was born in the wrong generation because I would have loved to have fit in with everybody back then. I mean, you gotta agree with me. Those were the days, huh?
Yeah, I, you know, I tell people, I try not to think that my nostalgia is any more important than anyone else's, but you do kind of see a change. I mean, everything kind of becomes a victim of its own success. Because by the time I got to Gold's, you know, it had moved to Santa Monica. Ken had turned the original gym into his home. And it was getting more popular. And then, you know, riding the wave of the movie Pumping Iron and all the popularity and the Uyghur magazines and how Arnold was taking it into the mainstream. When he finally sold, I mean, you know, you had movie stars coming in to train at the gym. They usually ended up training at home because people would kind of bother them. So, but you all of a sudden you had everyone that wanted to have muscles and that huge, yeah, that huge shift. But yeah, I think it was, you know, looking back, I think, you know, I John Balick, the publisher of Iron Man, in his interview, you know, he had said, I don't think it made the movie, it may have been an outtake, but he had said, I'm very happy for Ed and Pete and Tim when they bought it from Ken to license it and grow it. And he said, but you know, John Balick was an original Gold's Gym member in 1965. He was one of the first. And he said, he says to me, you started to get a lot less guys coming out all year round. He said, so the vibe of the gym changed. And he said, and you lost kind of like that tight-knit family group that was present, you know, definitely in the 60s and 70s. And he goes, I'm not saying it's better or different. He says, for my money, I preferred it the old way. He says, but I understand, you know, things have to grow, right? You have to strike while the iron's hot, you know. Definitely. So
I got a lot of things, guys, and we're going to talk about Marc and this movie. We got a lot more. What we're going to do, we're going to take this very brief break. When we come back, I got to figure out exactly how this all took off. I mean, guys, we got to light that wick, and we got to see how this exploded. We're going to take a brief break. We're coming back in just a couple of seconds. We got more Marc Martinez, guys. Dream big movie. Get over to dreambig.com and enjoy. You got to enjoy this movie, because wait until you see it. It is like a time machine back to when California California was amazing back then. And I'll tell you, not only that, bodybuilding was at the peak of the world and everybody was having a great time. I will tell you what, guys, we're coming back right after this very brief message. Stick around.
Hey guys, today's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Liquid IV. Liquid IV is the world's greatest hydration drink, and the best part is, it's good for you. Liquid IV is taking care of the Happy Hour Social Club members with 25% off. Guys, that is a great deal. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. They have great all-new flavors like guava, apple pie, watermelon, pina colada, strawberry, and the new Happy Hour-inspired tangerine. All these flavors are refreshing and delicious. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 25%. And speaking of refreshing and delicious, back to your host of the Happy Hour, KINGHAP.
Yeah, guys, I'll tell you, Liquid IV's done it again. Not only, like I said, when they made the Happy Hour tangerine, I was not only honored but thrilled, because it's one of the most delicious drinks I've ever had. Guys, get over to liquidiv.com, promo code KINGHAP, save yourself 25% site wide. You ain't gonna get a better promo code, because they want to be one of the premium sponsors of the Happy Hour Social Club. One thing you guys got to do, limited time only as of now, the new Tot Apple is amazing, and it's a limited time. I caught all kinds of crap because people missed out on cotton candy. Guys, when I tell you they're limited time, they're limited time. Get over to liquidiv.com, promo code KINGHAP, 25% site-wide. Boom. We are back. The producer of the Dream Bigs documentary. I will tell you, Marc, it is my pleasure to have you, but I need to know, number one, how did you get the inspiration to go ahead and film this movie? And two-part question. Second part is, I already know the answer to this one. Where did you get your inspiration to start your fitness journey back in the day? I'd like you to start with the movie, though, first.
Yeah, well, you know, I think for me, it was looking at the internet, and I kind of left the bodybuilding scene and world in about the middle 80s, and didn't really keep up with it. And then, you know, more than a decade and a half later, I'm at, you know, at work on a break, and I'm checking the internet and seeing where, you know, guys are. And obviously, you know, a lot of people are talking about that era, what they call the golden age of bodybuilding, and Gold's Gym and World Gym, and this period of time. And there was also people that were either guessing what it may have been like, or maybe some people were saying what it was like when it really wasn't, you know. And my first thought was, hey, I was there. Yep. You know, and part of me too is you know, I work in broadcast television, and I've always been kind of like I just like vetting facts, you know, regardless of what it is, even if it's pop culture or sports or whatever. I like to look at things in context. And so I'm like, well, you know, I can kind of tell a story here. Plus the fact that, you know, I do camera and video editing and lighting and sound. I'm like, I have the skills to be able to pull this off relatively cheap, you know, because I, you know, I won't have a crew. And so that was kind of my inspiration to say, wait, I was there. Let me reach out and see if I could, you know, find some guys and see if they would do it. So when I got a hold of Ken Sprague, and he had said, yeah, you know, he said a couple other guys, one was Bill Grant and one was Ken Waller. And he said, they're really excited about this. He says, but they called me because they wanted to vet you. They wanted to make sure that this is real. Yes. And he says, only because these guys have been promised so many things through the years that have never come through, that they just don't want it to be another one of those. So, and that was one of the things that kept me going when things got, you know, just, you know, really, really tough, you know, like where am I going to find the money or the time to eke this out? Yep. So that was kind of like the logistical thing. The thing that inspired me to pick up weights, you know, like most 13, 14 year old boys, you get your heart broken, you know, right. And, you know, and like guys, right. It's like, you know, I imagine girls are probably think, well, I mean, maybe guys were the same way, but, you know, like, ah, well, you know what, if maybe if I just had like, you know, more muscles, you know, maybe she, yeah. You know, cause that's our currency.
You all said it.
Yeah. At that age, right. At 13, 14, it's not a car yet, you know, and, you know, and then also too, it helps you for sports. And that's another thing, right? It's like, oh, well, you know, they, all the girls like the, you know, the, you know, the best athletes or the, you know, the whatever. So that kind of obviously spurred me. And I'm sure that could be shared with millions of guys, you know, the first time they pick up that barbell.
Absolutely. And you know, you start off somewhere, you don't know what the hell's going on. I've been blessed because even though it was years and years later, I actually started out in a small private gym. It's no longer, unfortunately, no longer open, but it's called Oasis Gym in Everett, Massachusetts. And the gentleman, his name was Louis Nuzzo, who taught me everything I know about weightlifting. I mean, we're talking 25 years later. And I mean, I'm still a personal trainer and stuff. I have to learn pretty much everything from him, but he built every piece of equipment in the gym himself by hand with, you know, what the hell, basically, you know, put together the equipment himself. And he, you know, went ahead and got all kinds of weights, but put them together, built like hammer strength type machines and Nautilus type machines. And that's very similar to Bill Gold when he started out the first Golds before it went to Ed Sprague, correct?
Yeah. Joe Gold had I can't remember the name of the other gentleman, but there was a guy named Dan Howard, who, when Ken Sprague bought the gym, Dan Howard stayed as a manager, but they would build the equipment in Joe Gold's backyard or his garage. And he would use, you know, Joe was a merchant marine, and he was also, I think his dad owned a junkyard in East Los Angeles. Where Joe grew up in a place called Boyle Heights, which is in East LA. And Joe was pretty handy with the blowtorch and welding. And he loved lifting weights. They said again, and even Joe started by getting bullied. They said that he had to pick up iron to get bigger and quote unquote get respect. Yep. And he used to wear overalls, and Dan Howard and a few of the other guys said that Joe's nickname as a teenager was Little Abner because he looked like the old cartoon, you know, guy with the, you know, the overalls and the big, you know, muscles, a big, huge physique. So, yeah. And I think that was the thing is that, that equipment that Joe built, it was there. There's probably some pieces still at the Gold's Hampton, all these years later that were built by Joe because they just stayed with the gym. I know, two guys bought it from Joe named, Dave Sachs and Bud Danitz, and they owned it for barely 2 years.
This equipment is still in use.
There is some equipment that is still there. Yeah. There was, the cable crossover machine. In fact, it would be good to ask Ed Connors, because I remember when I was at the Golds in Santa Monica and all the equipment was still there. There was a few new pieces. There was like a really nice Nautilus leg curl and leg press, not a, a leg extension and leg curl. And then they started building their own equipment too. Ken Sprague had a little area in the back where he's like, let's start building equipment and sell it under the Gold's Gym line. But there's some old pieces that have probably been reupholstered, but made the trip from Pacific Avenue to Second Street and then back to Hampton that are still in existence. Yeah.
That is unreal. And it's funny, you know, from the VIP chat room, a couple of quick things is, because like I said, Louis Nuzzo built his machines himself, and he actually, Yeah, I can tell you what, there was a leg press machine he had that without adding a piece of weight to the thing would pop a hernia. This thing was so damn heavy. I don't even know what that whole thing was built out of. I have no clue, but I can tell you, you had the strongest legs in the town if you were working out at Oasis. But he says, Louis Nuzzo, a.k.a. Spencer Fajaya's hitman, that his fame came from being Spencer Fajaya's hitman. Yes, Bean Town. And one of the other things there, I've seen Happy Hour Social Club VIP member Tony Duckett wanted to go ahead and throw some love. Says that this film was actually at a couple of film festivals. I was looking for the name of the one that he just said, Red something or other, that when it was at Red Moon Film Festival 5 months back, selected this documentary as the best feature. And then he says, nice to meet you, Marc. I mean, is that accurate? This was listed as the best film feature at for a documentary?
Yeah, the film's been selected into 7. Red Moon Film Festival, Edit Play Film, International Film Festival, the Toronto, Canada International Film Festival, the Culver City Film Festival, the Malibu Film Festival, and I'm trying to think, Hollywood Golden Age Film Festival.
Culver City?
Yeah, it's yeah, and Culver City, yeah, and that's yeah. It was great when Ed came out, and I had Ed and another gentleman that we both know take pictures with me in the backdrop there at the Culver City Film Festival. It was good to catch up with Ed. But, I mean, I'm happy and overjoyed, you know, because you make something and you look at it for so long. I mean, I don't know if you're editing a podcast or if you're writing an article or something, you've edited it for so long. I don't even know if this is good anymore. You've kind of lost your perspective. You have to give it to someone else.
You're scrutinized. So, yes.
Yeah, exactly. So yeah, you get in the weeds with it. So when someone else, says, hey, it's good enough to be selected, or we think it's the best, documentary feature, I'm honored, you know. I mean, yep.
Our friends over at the Boston International Film Festival, I'm going to go ahead and tag them because we need to get this here in Boston, get it on the big screen over here, and we need this up there. Well, I'll tell you what, a lot of people need to see this. They just introduced the new Boston Pro here in Massachusetts, which is nice, and there's a bodybuilding's coming back a little bit here as Mr. Olympia gets more and more popular, as we'll be out there in December, thankfully. I'm very excited to get out there for the Mr. Olympia. They have us out there as VIP, and I appreciate that. But as I sit here and I watch this movie, right? I mean, I'll tell you what, I wanted to get up and start shadow boxing. Got me all pumped up. You got all these, you know, Arnold and everything. One of the funnier things I seen is, you know, I mean, they went ahead and Ed Sprague, you spoke about, he goes ahead and he kind of brings the fitness industry down there, you know, with Gold's Gym and everything. He goes ahead and tries to make it more Hollywood. He invites people in. If you want to come in here and film something, feel free. Just have to have on, you know, you have to have on your Gold's Gym and make sure you show the Gold's Gym equipment, etc. So there was a lot of movies, a lot of commercials, a lot of documentary type features that were filmed there, and they brought in more and more because Ed would welcome it, and as long as he was getting the positive publicity, he'd allow you to come in and film for free. I mean, down the line, I mean, to so many different levels, that is genius.
Yeah, you know, yeah, Ken, you know, you've seen businessmen, and the guys that are like, look, I'll give this.
Yep.
You know, versus the guys that are like, what's in it for me? You know, if they're always from a transactional point of view, you know, you might make some short-term money, but you never grow. And like you said, Kenneth said, if you want to come down to the gym and shoot an episode of your TV series, feel free, but everyone's going to have a Gold's Gym shirt on. You know, he was very good at building that synergy.
Yes.
You know, and then also too, you know, because Ken also had friends in, you know, like the actress Katherine Hepburn, an old Hollywood director named George Cooker, and a few other people. And so he ran in those circles. So he knew like magazines like Variety or Hollywood Reporter or some of the other industry magazines. He's like, if I can get one of these writers to come out to Gold's Gym, you know, and write an article on the gym. So he says, you know, you get this guy who is used to writing about actors and actresses and press agents at, you know, restaurants in Beverly Hills and Malibu. And then to come to this, you know, little sweaty, almost army barracks type of place, two blocks from the beach, and see, and I'm sure that he goes, you know, he said it was just, it was just a mind blower for someone from that world to come into that world, write about it, and give it a glowing report. So once the Hollywood industry people saw to say, oh, well, we have to be in on everything. We have to be the cutting edge of everything. And then I think that really helped, because that happened right about the time that the movie Pumping Iron hit, and Arnold had his press agents out in, you know, the general public getting him out there. And he was a great face for bodybuilding. All you had to do was look at the movie. And so I worked out at Gold's Gym. There's Ken Sprague at the other end, who's the owner of Gold's Gym, getting it out there. And like Charles Gaines had said, the man who wrote Pumping Iron, you know, that soundbite from the film, when he said this was a perfect, it was like dominoes falling. It was a synchronicity of good luck events that just all had to happen in sequence for this to happen. You know, so, you know, there's always a little luck involved, no doubt.
No, yeah, I agree. I had another question came in from the VIP, so I got to throw it out there. Wants to know what your favorite Venice story is. Someone may not know while filming. Like, what was your favorite story from Venice? I know we some of them can't be, some of them may not be appropriate for the show, but you got to have a good one for us.
Well, these would be coming secondhand because I was at the Santa Monica gym, but Ken had said that women would wander into Gold's, the original Gold's at 1006 Pacific Avenue. And not that they were, you know, officially members, but he said that not only would co-ed workouts take place, but sometimes co-ed showers. So, and that was at the original one. So, but I wasn't a firsthand witness to that. I was at the Santa Monica one. It was a bit more civilized, you know, but,
if you can call it that, right?
Yeah,
But one of the other things, too, is I seen people would go in there, work out, get all sweaty and gross. They'd run, jump right into the ocean, right down the street with their clothes on, wash their clothes and themselves at the same time, come on out, let it dry, and go about their day. I mean, we're talking about a multimillionaire telling this story, too, on the show. I mean, on the documentary. Funny hearing that coming from somebody who, down the line, ends up owning Gold's Gym and, you know, ends up, you know, being the owner till 1990.
Oh yeah, Pete. You know what a story of just belief in yourself, and also taking the road less traveled. You know, because I think Ed told you when he was out in Florida looking at working for Disney World to design Epcot. That's where he met Pete, and Pete was flying out to LA, he wanted to come out to LA, and then Ed said he would fly him, but there was two contests going on. There was the AAU Mr. America, which Pete had already placed second or third a few times. And some people called him the uncrowned Mr. America. And then there was also the AFAB, which that was the organization at the time. That was the amateur arm of the IFBB. So that was like Weeder's Mr. America. And they were within like a week or two of each other. So Pete said, you know, I'm living on the roof of the Orange Avenue gym in Florida, in Orlando. I don't have money to fly to LA and get to the contest. Ed Connors flies him out there. And like Pete said, I have to live cheap. You know, I'm not going to, I think Ed eventually like, hey, Pete, come use my place. But Pete was he figured, he goes, I like to train at night anyway. I can train overnight when the gym's closed. During the day, I can sleep under the pier. I could jump in the ocean as a shower. And there was a McDonald's. I think the McDonald's is still there. about one block from Santa Monica Pier, there's a McDonald's. And he said, I met a girl that worked there and they would throw away the day old hamburgers. And she goes, she would save them up for me. He said, so, I left my car in Florida. I sold it for whatever money I could have. I didn't have an apartment. I was eating burgers for free and sleeping on the beach. And then, to 2 years later, being one of the guys that buys golds and then how many ever years later sells it for $44 million.
Damn.
You're just like, and Pete says, and I'm a high school dropout, it's like, if you talk about self-belief, I mean, you got to have a little luck, but.
You're right though. Luck mixed with hard work and determination. I mean, it's only truthfully, it's a recipe for success, but at the same time, you got to have a brass set to pull off.
That's right.
Pull that off, I'll tell you.
Absolutely.
Sitting under the pier, eating day old hamburgers and then working out overnight and at the gym. Craziness. But I'll tell you what, he ends up splitting $44 million. So I guess he did all right. You got to go there. Guys, we're going to take one more brief break. We're going to be back with Marc Martinez, the producer and director for the Dream Big documentary, A Golden Time in the Golden State. Guys, we're coming right back real quick after this very brief message, guys. Make sure you stick around.
Hey guys, tonight's episode of the Happy Hour is brought to you by Chili Sleep Technology. Chili Sleep Systems is a game changer. Chili's Cool Mesh Pad is the most luxurious sleep system in the industry and is also hydro-powered. This can warm you up on those cold winter evenings or cool you off during a steamy summer night. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 22% off an entire sleep system. This is certainly a purchase that you will not regret. Our systems can bring the temperature anywhere from 55 degrees to 115 by remote control or the Chili Sleep app. Get over to chilitechnology.com and make sure to use promo code KINGHAP to save 22%. And now, back to a man that needs absolutely no help warming it up in between the sheets, your host of the Happy Hour, KINGHAP.
Oh, yeah. You guys know I love Chili Sleep Technology, guys. Get over to chilisleep.com. They've actually increased your promotional code. You can save 30% now with promo code KINGHAP, guys. Get over to Chili Sleep. What the hell are you waiting for? It was 90 degrees Sunday, and I ain't got my air conditioner in right now. So I'll tell you what, if it wasn't for that Chili Sleep Technology, I would have had to visit our friends over at Fresh Balls. I'll tell you what. But do me a favor, guys. Make sure you get over to chilisleep.com, use promo code KINGHAP, let them know you're with the Happy Hour Social Club, and you want 30% off the absolute peak you will save. I'll tell you what, guys, one last thing about Chili Sleep. They're running their Memorial Day sale right now, which is their biggest sale of the year, and on that sale, you save 30%. But because you're a Happy Hour Social Club insiders, you always do, so make sure you guys remember KINGHAP over at chilisleep.com. And I'll tell you, Marc, sleeping is one of the absolute biggest things. Number one, for recovery from anything. I mean, hangover, definitely hard work. But yeah, I mean, sleep is important. I always say, having a comfortable night's sleep is amazing when you have Chili Sleep. But forget about Chili Sleep for a moment. You tell me. I mean, sleep is absolutely number one overall. I mean, somebody who's in broadcasting as well as making movies, I mean, finding time to catch those Z's must be tough for you, pal.
Yeah, it's huge. You know, I mean, I listen, when I listen to podcasts and listening to other ones, and you get the biohackers or the doctors, and now you've probably heard them, that there are so many podcasts now where doctors are correlating the difference between deep REM sleep and our overall quality of health and the quality of sleep and how it affects everything. But yeah, I mean, yeah, I love sleep.
Oh, I do. I'll tell you what, when you get a good night's sleep, right now I'm recovering from ankle surgery. So I'll tell you what, I mean, rolled, you know, twisting and turning at night. I'm frigging screaming. Like, it sounds like a hyena sleeping in my room. I'm frigging howling at the moon. But I'll tell you what, I nothing beats a good night's sleep. I can't wait to go ahead, when this is over with and to start getting those deep, deep night's sleep. I'll tell you, one of the other things here, I mean, the VIP chat room is going crazy. I love you all so much. I got, so down there in that area, right, when you were down there. Now, you went down a lot, obviously, to go ahead and record this movie, interview some people. You interviewed some people on the beach. I mean, a lot of Mr. Americas and, Mr. Western America, I believe, was one of the things. How funny is this that the gentleman actually said, they set up a show, Mr. Western America, Gold's first ever contest, and the guest poses were Ken Waller and Arnold Schwarzenegger, and they got $50. Yeah. Imagine that. Holy shit.
When Ken, you know, Joe Gold built Gold's and opened it in 65. He sold it in 1970. Two guys owned it in between for about a year and a half. Ken bought it in 72. And he said, when I bought it, and you know the story, but he said, when I bought it, Gold's, and it's hard for guys to think in this day and age, because they see Gold's as like the still pretty much ground, or at least the brand name, ground zero for bodybuilding. But he said they had never even put on a bodybuilding contest before. So he held a contest at a club that had become like a comedy club on Sunset Boulevard back in the glory days of Hollywood, like the 40s and 50s. Ciro's used to be like a chic watering hole, you know, for the studio actors and whatnot. And then to think, like in 1972, you had Mr. Olympia and Junior Mr. America Ken Waller, you know, getting paid $50 to guest pose.
He was the first owner of Gold's Gym to actually sponsor and hold bodybuilding competitions. His promotional skills in the film industry helped build the establishment's profile. That's perfectly stated. And one of the things with Ed, I noticed, is Ed was very, very into marketing. And Gold's Gym blew up under him, and then even further under Ed, and down the line with Pete and Tim as well. But I mean, basically, this was all marketed, and the way that they marketed it, and you cover this in your movie, was basically like going to the gym was like going to church. And also, it was like, this is what you were doing. You were eating, sleeping, working out. And like I said, if you were one of those suckers that had to have a job, you'd go to work as well. But it was just down that area. It was like people were out riding bikes, skateboards, everything, etc. And on top of it all, they were living that like hippie style life. Yeah. And I mean, a lot of people were having a real good time, right?
Yeah, it was very bohemian. You know, when you had mentioned that about working, I laughed because Bill Grant, and there was this one guy, a bodybuilder named Ron DiPolito. And there were a couple of other guys, and they said Ron was on disability. And he was the only guy we knew that was on disability. They go, there was a connecting door between the gym and the house next door. And Ron would walk into the house and then go through into the gym just in case an insurance guy saw him. I go, Ron would be in the gym deadlifting and squatting and whatever, and working disability. And yeah. then Ken Sprague also said, he goes, we also had two medical doctors that collected unemployment, and they were in the gym all the time. So, and you know, it was cheap to live, right now there's, you know, two bedroom apartments in Venice that are going for close to $4,000 a month, maybe a little more. And back then,
damn,
you know, yeah, back then it was, even for market rate, and you know, if you adjust for 1960s or 1970s dollars, it was still cheap because it was, you know, growing up in LA, they said Venice was where the debris meets the sea. That was the reputation it had. But it still didn't stop people from going out there and having fun.
Oh, yeah. I mean, thinking about it, like you said, it's about $4,000 a month for a two bedroom. Back then you were paying $150 and you had a roommate or something. You know what I mean?
Yeah.
It was just a different world back then. And it was refreshing to see in this movie. Another good question here. Will this be at any additional upcoming film festivals coming up anytime soon? I mean, obviously people reach out to you to go ahead and have it, you know, featured, etc. But I mean, is there anything in the plans right now to go ahead and be at additional film festivals?
Well, you mentioned the Boston one. Maybe I'll check that out. But I had two companies reach out to me to distribute it. Both of them, the deal wasn't very good. It didn't favor me. And so I've been looking at ways to self-distribute. And I spoke with a person, and she had recommended doing a showing at like conventions, like a fitness expo.
Mr. Olympia. And
yeah, and do what they call a four wall. So what I have to find out, I actually spoke to a person. They just got done with the fitness expo in LA. There's another one in San Jose, which is up here in the Bay Area near me. And I think that might be the way I have to go. But I do want to up, if nothing happens, if I can't get any sponsors to generate interest through those shows, I'll probably either upload straight to Amazon.
Yep.
And or I'll see what the cost is for DVDs, even though I know that's kind of an antiquated, medium. I think for some people, they still might want a DVD.
To be honest, it's weird to think that DVDs are actually kind of getting obsolete. I mean, when this movie started taking place, I don't even know if there was VHS back then.
Yeah.
But to think we've jumped all the way through that. But I'll tell you what, there's places here in Boston, and you know what? I'm going to make sure I tag them in this when we go ahead and re-release it. I'd love to see this up at Somerville Theater or down in Kendall Square, guys. If you know, all our friends out there, like I said, the Boston International Film Festival, it happens once a year, and they have a bunch of, independent movies and stuff. But I'd love to see it at that, but balling on a budget. To your question right now, no, he doesn't have any plans as of now, but keep your eyes peeled and make sure you stick around, because I'll tell you what, when Marc does have additional places, he'll make sure he tags me on social media, and we'll get that definitely pumped out to you guys. Another question I have for you is this something that you think, I mean, will lead to more documentaries? I know that this one here, you basically lived, but is this a one and done for you? Or is this something you think you may revisit in the end, making more movies, helping produce, maybe, you know, down the line doing something crazy and, you know, jumping in on even a big money flick, you know what I mean? Maybe you could, you know, is this something you think that you're going to segue into, or you're a news guy and this is just a one-off?
No, I kind of fell into TV. Yeah. I really wanted to be in film. But yeah, definitely want to do another doc. I wanted to do one on the music scene in Los Angeles in about the same time period. Some snags have hit with people that don't want to cooperate or you can't make them be interviewed. So, but oddly enough, I just communicated with Tim Kimber, and he's going to get in touch with Pete, because when Pete Grimkowski saw the movie, and I spoke with Pete, I enjoy our phone calls, and Pete had said, you know, he goes, Marc, you have to continue the story. Now you have to start the story of me, Ed, and Tim. And, I told Pete, I said, you know, between when they took over the gym in late 79 to 99, I go, it would take me two movies to get from 1979 to 1989 alone. But actually, Tim and I and Pete are going to conference call and see if there's anything there to do a Gold's Gym doc starting. Yeah. Yeah.
I love the idea, and I'll tell you what, you know, especially with Ed and his new book and the Three Muscle Tears, guys, and you know, you go with Tim and Pete, and geez, Pete seems like quite the character. We got to get him on the Happy Hour one of these days. He seems like quite the character. But I mean, I think that sounds like a fantastic, fantastic idea. I'm doing a part two and moving into that phase, and then who knows, I could move into when, you know, Gold's Gym gets sold, etc. I love the idea, and you did such a great job with Dream Big. I know that you must be very motivated to continue, correct?
Yeah, you know, it's odd. It's like at one point you kind of feel like, oh, okay, I'm going to set this aside and move in a different direction in terms of subject matter for a film. But then at other times, especially with this next one, with people putting ideas out there and thinking, like, how can we pool resources and pull other people in to make it happen? I'm not going to fight against it, you know, because it's something that I know the subject matter of that era very well. And, you know, it was a passion of mine. And now that I have a track record with it, it could be easier. And the one good thing, there was a gym member named Magic Schwartz, who was at the original Golds, at the Santa Monica Golds, and then as well as the Hampton Street Golds. And Magic was one, he was smart enough to, he had a VHS camera, you know, one of the first ones. And, but he was smart enough to not only just take it to the gym a lot and shoot footage, but also get guys to sign release forms so that he has the rights to show their image, because you kind of need that. And yeah. He says, he's got years and years of video footage of some guys that aren't around anymore and some big names. And that helps tell the story a lot easier when you have the archival footage, you know, when it's already there. That makes the storytelling, you know, a lot easier.
Yes. And it makes a lot less for having to go ahead and like reenact. And
right. Right. Which I had to do. Yeah.
Understood. Magic from Over the Top was the question. Is that Magic from Over the Top from the Stallone movie?
I believe so.
I mean, imagine if that was. Forget about it. That's unbelievable. I'll tell you what, man. I am having a fantastic time here, guys. And I mean, Mark's been like so generous with his time. Make sure you absolutely, absolutely show him some love. So just so everybody knows, as always, I love it when it comes to this time of the night. No, it isn't game over. It's last call. Ladies and gentlemen, last call, where Marc Martinez is being brought to you by our great friends at Clearwater Distillery. Clearwater Distillery is the official top shelf alcohol of the Happy Hour Social Club, and it is the most delicious small batch alcohol on planet Earth today. Promo code KINGHAP will save you 10% site-wide. And if you cheap bastards spend over $100, we'll ship it to you for free. How you like those apples, Granny Smith? Guys, get over to Clearwater Distillery. Use promo code KINGHAP. Save yourself some money. Get some of the most delicious, I'll tell you what, scandalous. You notice I ain't showing scandalous right now because that shit is so delicious. I've already drank all of mine. I got to get in touch with Matt or Claire over there at Clearwater Distillery. Guys, when you get over there, use promo code KINGHAP. Let them know you're with the Happy Hour Social Club. Mark, it's last call, brother. Do me a favor. Should people want to see this movie? I mean, we don't have a spot for them to see it just yet. But I like I said, you'll go ahead. I'm sure you'll tag me on your Instagram or Twitter, etc. And we'll get that shared and we'll let everybody know. But should they want to find it, etc., where can they find you on social media? Should they want to follow you for those updates?
Well, I have a Dream Big Facebook page, and dreambigdoc.com. Just to do a read up on the movie. And then I'm on Instagram
and Twitter
also on Twitter as Body Surf Bliss.
Oh,
and yeah. Yes.
Give him some love on social media and we'll make sure, guys, I'll make sure I tag him in the notes and stuff in the show. And also the link to the website will be in the show notes. So if you guys are listening on Apple Pod or on our YouTube channel, guys, make sure give some love on the YouTube, give it a subscribe, guys. But yes, we'll make sure all the links to this are in there and I will make sure to let you guys know when this is going to hit the theaters again. Do me a favor, Mark. I just need to know, is there anything left you got for the Happy Hour Social Club members, Big Dog?
Thank you, Mike, for having me. And I just want to do my best to get this thing out there so that we could finally get it out there rather than like, when's it going to come out?
Yeah.
Because I think it's a peer back that I think it's a world that's long gone. And maybe bodybuilding fans or strength and fitness fans didn't even know existed. So, you know, thank you.
Absolutely. We're thrilled to have you. You're always a VIP here in the Happy Hour Social Club. And I'll tell you what, big man, I'm really, really excited. Speaking of VIPs of the Happy Hour Social Club, I'm going to keep Mark right here, guys. I'm going to talk to him when we get off the air. I got something I got to go over with him. But do me a favor, guys, when we get off the air right now, I need you to do me a favor and enjoy Happy Hour Social Club VIP Abyss version 2. Ladies and gentlemen, it is the Happy Hour. Good night, ladies and gentlemen. I love you. We will see you on the live show.
Yeah. Abyss. Happy Hour. Happy Hour. AbyssHipHop.com. Sports fanatics applauding at the matches. Picking winners when we sift through the brackets. Yeah. Turf green like a bag of sour. We're gonna talk in that podcast is the Happy Hour. Meta come to the game fully geared. Who would dare? I've been beast mode since the rookie year. Yeah. Little fact for the lightning round. This is Title Town, the place where all of the fire's found. We attend games on the regular. Heard more goals than a motivation seminar. Yeah. Stay charged like a visa. So when we bag calls, no, we stopping by the most bleachers. So click play and just soak it up. This is Happy Hour, but not the same as your local pub. Sports talk, hit the pro shows a must. Just go like the page, call the Happy Hour Social Club. Boss moves, so you know your boy paid them dues. Front row, you can see us through your pay-per-view. Fights on, watching them box like big parcels. The MMA, know that the art is mixed martial. Listen, guests, you better play your best. You play invest, you better go take a breath and just play the bench. Yeah. Clap hard with these two hands.
You've been true fans, reading stats off the newsstand.